forget about Sunday pre-service prayer time. Oh yeah, hit play, I forgot to do that.
There you go.
Again, Sunday pre-service prayer time starts at 9:30. That's in the room just to your right as you walk in the glass doors at the front of the church. Also, recently I finished the Tell Someone Bible Study. I know everyone enjoyed that. We learned many great principles on how to share God's love with all others in the community. And we have also seen visitors almost every week here, so praise the Lord on that. God's growing us and our church. This coming Wednesday night, that will be January 4th, we will work on taking down and putting away the holiday decorations. So if you can, come early. And
so enjoy them today, right?
What's that?
Enjoy them today.
Enjoy the day. So again, if you can, come early to help with that. We also have a teaching on prayer, and we'll spend time in God's presence, and we'll just have some good fellowship here at the church. And as the church takes many people stepping up, and also using the gifts and talents that God has given us. And recently, Marla has helped organize many of the church lunches and dinners. So we're very thankful for her for that. After the Denver Christmas parade, she had chili and salad ready for many that were a part of that community event. Also, last Wednesday night, she prepared a wonderful hot dog supper, and wish I could have been here for that, because I can eat a couple of hot dogs when I'm in the mood. And so we appreciate Marla. She is making a difference here. excuse me, we thank her very, very much. We also have Holy Communion this month, the 11th and the 29th. And do you know recently our church gave our final giving toward missions giving for 2016. Each of the last 3 years we have seen an increase in giving, so praise the Lord for that. We are believing we will see an even bigger increase in 2017. And may we all listen to God and obey Him in all areas of our lives, including in missions giving. Also, prayer and fasting. We invite and encourage everyone who can commit at the beginning of this 2017 year for a time of prayer and fasting. God does answer prayer. We all can do something, so we can listen to God and obey Him. Also, a church luncheon, January 22nd. That will be right after the church service. Also, coming soon, we'll have a church bulletin that will be posted in the coming weeks. And the Real Men Conference 2017. Pastor Mike and I took in that conference last year down in Columbia, South Carolina. Great conference. I really enjoyed it. So, I definitely plan to be back there again this year. That's going to be March 17th and 18th. That's at the Christian Life Church, as I just mentioned, down in Columbia. And, of course, the church website, this church, newdestinydenver.org, is updated on a regular basis. So you can check out the website for any postings, information on upcoming events, or to catch some of the past sermons. So at this time, we'll be taking prayer requests.
My good friend, who was my roommate after college, her cousin is in the final stages of sarcoma, a rare kind of sarcoma. She's only 40, she's got four kids, and I actually was friends with her in college as well. Her name is Kristen, and if you could pray for them. She just texted me and said they're going to try an experimental treatment on her now. But if that doesn't work, then they go to hospice. Just pray for Kristen and her husband Tim and their four children.
Amen.
She's ready. She's ready to the Lord. She's ready to see the Lord, but she's just devastated.
Any unspoken requests? Lord knows all about them. Let's go to the Lord in prayer. Father, we thank you for this wonderful day that you have given us. We know that you will bless the coming new year. We ask for prayer and comfort for Kristen and her family as she is battling this disease. She with her husband, and her four children. Surround them with your arms of love and grace and mercy. Be with all of us here as we go out into the community today after the church service. Let us be a light to those that are lost or undone. We know you will bless the service. And we know you will be here with us today, in Jesus' name.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. Amen.
Well, that was a good service of worship. All right.
Amen.
Time in God's presence.
So who has a word for 2017? So I've heard some people just pray that the Lord gives them a word just to focus on and to dwell on for 2017. And this morning, God gave me the word gratitude. So this is my year to be thankful. Instead of, I'm sorry, I'm going to say I'm thankful. Instead of, I don't have, I'm going to say I'm thankful that I do have. So I challenge everyone to pray for the Lord to give you a word. You can use the one that he gave me, or just ask him to reveal a new one for you, because gratitude goes a long way, especially when you kind of see the world in its fullness, when you see all the suffering and all the tragedies that are happening in this world, you become more thankful, and more thankful for everything the Lord has done and continues to do. So we just pray that this year, Lord, that you would give us hearts of thankfulness, Lord, thankful for what you have done for us. Even if you don't do any more for us, you have already done enough in giving us your Son, Father God. So we praise you for your Son. We praise you for saving us, for redeeming us, for making us your children, Father. And we thank you for growing us and showing us what is true, what we have to be thankful for, Father God. Convict us when we complain, convict us when we worry, Lord, and give us confidence to trust in you, Father God. God, we love you. We dedicate 2017 to your service, Father God, that we would serve you and serve you with joy, and God, that you would, this would be the year of Jubilee, that you would celebrate, Father God, this year in your presence, Lord. Thank you, God.
Thank you. Have communion today, so we'll do that in the midst of this song. This is a good one. Thank you.
Yeah, let's hold the bread.
Well, God, we come before you and we thank you, Jesus, for your broken body for each one of us. And Lord God, we just pray right now as we start this new year, we pray that we would remember what life is about. Life is about living for you. Life is about doing what pleases you. And we thank you and we partake in remembrance of you in Jesus' name. Amen. Let's hold the cup. Lord God, we just thank you. We thank you, Jesus, for your shed blood. We know there's power in the blood, and we just thank you. And Lord, I pray, we pray right now that you would just give us fresh eyes, fresh renewal, and fresh relationship with you. And we thank you. In Jesus' name, amen. And then we're going to continue to worship in just a moment. As part of worship as well, I'll go ahead and mention that while worship is going on, you're welcome to bring up any tithes or offerings. And listen, it's all God's. And it's not only what we give in an offering plate, it's we should live our whole life as an offering unto the Lord. But part of it is in tithes and offerings. And there's a plate up here and a plate in the back. Lord, we just pray right now as we're in your presence and we thank you for this new year. But Lord, I just pray right now, Lord God, that you would increase in our lives and as a church, our resources, our gifts, our talents, but also in the finances. And Lord, we thank you. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen. Amen.
His presence. I was taken care of on his plane, not mine. Not here,
not on this earth. I was taken to him, up there with him. I was somewhere with him.
Hallelujah.
Not on this planet. Couldn't have been. There's no way. It was too peaceful. And
yes.
By doing so, I remember being in a building, and I remember walking out the door, and somebody said, "Let me walk with you." I said, "Okay." Didn't see a beard, didn't see the normal signs you would think of Jesus. You know, everybody sees these pictures on the wall. Jesus has got a beard, Jesus has got this. Jesus can be whatever he wants to be.
Amen.
But he asked me to walk, if he could walk with me. I said, yes. And we walked and we went to another place. And it was like a party was going on. There was balloons and just all this stuff was going on.
Hallelujah.
And then this larger than life person came up. And one by one, these things started disappearing. And the only thing that was left was him that walked with me and the larger than life gentleman that was with us. And then it hit me. Nothing on this earth means anything. Nothing. Only Jesus and God his Father.
Hallelujah.
Those are the ones that mean everything to a person. And it was shown to me in such a way as to take everything away, and all that's left are them, the Father and the Son. And then I was taken somewhere else. And I remember speaking in tongues, and I remember being talked to by people I knew. And as I was speaking in tongues, the last person that talked to me told me, "He has completed in you what needs to be done."
Hallelujah.
And I was like, okay. And during all this, a younger little kid sat beside me and said, "Mr. Grady," that's my first name. He said, "Everything's going to be all right."
Wow, thank you, Jesus.
Okay, I'm good with that. And then I woke up, and I was just in a sweat. I just woke up. And when I looked, opened my eyes, and it was like my entire perspective changed of everything in my room. And I was just like, wow, you know. So I called the first person that I know that came to mind to get a little clarification on what had just happened. And she's a lot like yourself, Joan. She is very in touch with the Lord. She loves God. She loves him very much. And she knows scripture from one end of that Bible to the other. And she brought up and she said, "You need to read this." And she told me Ephesians 4. And as I read it out loud, I came to one spot. And when it came to that spot, it was like a light went off. "And be renewed in the spirit of your mind. And that ye put on the new man, which after God has created in righteousness and true holiness. Wherefore, putting away lying, speak every man truth with his neighbor, for we are members one of another. Be ye angry, and sin not. Let not the sun go down upon your wrath, neither give place to the devil. Let him that stole steal no more, but rather let him labor, working with his hands, the thing which is good, that he may have to give to him that needeth. Let not corrupt communication proceed out of your mouth, which is good to the use of edifying, that it may minister grace unto the hearers. And grieve not the Holy Spirit of God.
Hallelujah.
Whereby ye are sealed until the day of redemption." When I read that, it was kind of interesting. Because I went to my phone and she had sent a text, and guess what was in that text? Basically the same thing. And I was like, "Lord, thank you. Thank you. I can't get over how good God is."
How good God is.
Ah, he's good all the time. Good all the time. So with that, I'm going to sing this song. And and it really speaks a lot to my heart because of what the words mean and what the words ask it for. And I think we all can take some advice from what the song is asking for.
Amazing singers, you know, and they're doing it to glorify God.
Amen.
Yes. Every one of them, you know, and that's what it's about. God gave you gifts to use, so use them for Him, serve Him.
Amen.
That's all we can do.
Amen.
Thank you.
voice is like, oh, guys, that's not it.
Thank you. can trust you. We thank you, Lord God, that you are always there for us, and we do not have to worry or stress. We know that you care for us and that you are in full control, Lord God.
Amen.
Lord God, we know that this, every day, but this new year, Lord God, that you have great plans for us as we obey and listen to you, Lord God. And I ask, Lord God, that you would give us ears to hear, Lord God. Give us hearts to receive, we pray, in the name of Jesus. And Lord God, we thank you. And in Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. Well, God is here to touch our, or he is touching our lives. He's everywhere, as Dwayne just mentioned. But certainly I believe as we come together with like-minded hearts, is that, you know what, that it'll spread. It'll spread when Dwayne shares a testimony. It'll hit our hearts. And yeah, when we come together, listen, I've mentioned that certainly as we grow, and maybe we need to multi-use this room at some point, but you know what, that has to come to that point, because otherwise I think there's something sacred about the sanctuary, all right? I mean,
amen.
Yes, the
amen.
Temple is us connecting to God, but still, we like to keep it sacred.
Amen.
And so anyway, hey, I heard a drummer up here. You did pretty good. All right? There's two Dwaynes, bass player Dwayne, maybe three, also a singing Dwayne. All right, but I thought it sounded pretty good, too. Yeah. So good job doing the drums. Appreciate it. And we certainly are praying for more musicians. But listen, we want the right people that God has for us as a church and church family. I am excited that, thank you for everyone being here. New Year's Day. Some churches cancel New Year's Day. I was like, well, their churches all party. And so listen, we don't, I've mentioned this, we don't judge. We don't have to say because people aren't here. You know, that's whatever. That's, everyone makes the right choice and what God tells them. But you know, some churches close for Christmas. And I was like, isn't that what it's about? And we had actually more than I expected last week. We had a few visitors. And I'm impressed. I was talking, hope you don't mind my shirts, Crystal, but listen, I'm scheduled, I'm busy, all right? And if I don't have something on schedule, Melissa, I'll put a chore on this. But anyways, but she'll say, you forgot about this. I said, Melissa, you don't have to tell me every 6 months. Anyways, that's a husband joke. But Crystal's like, she just, like, where she visits home, I won't get all she does for work, but then she said, but her alarm thing went off and we're on her schedule. Church is on her schedule. So, all right, that's how it should be. Amen. So I was excited to hear that. And so, listen, I thought about that. Melissa and I went on a peaceful date and without the children. We love our kids. My parents watched the kids last night, early evening. And she was, Melissa, like, so what are some goals? And started asking those deep questions, right? You know. And I said, well, you know, I think it's good to have goals, but I think it's good to set good habits in the beginning of the year, to some of them to refresh. And one we thought of, or I mentioned, is and I talked about this last year, beginning of the year, but sometimes we got to remind ourselves, is put this thing down, right? You know, it's, yes, we need to look, we should respond to people, but listen, if we're with some friends, we don't need to be sitting there looking at that thing constantly, amen? And it becomes, you know, and it's first, now I know Jim's texting and witnessing. I see her on the phone. She's witnessing right now. She's telling someone, all right. And, but put it down. You know, we go to work and we spend so much time. You know, another thing, that mind our own business. You know, sometimes people can be busy. We can be busybodies, or we're on social media and we think, man, I wish I had what they have. Well, let's get something straight. People don't typically post all their bad stuff. Some people do, but majority, they're posting their vacations or their new car or their happy faces, where they've done like 20 pictures to get the perfect picture. All right, is that true? All right. Mm-hmm. And that's okay to do, John. You know, show us good as a church. That's fine. But that's the, you know, the truth. But we can get envious. We can get jealous. And God wants us to be what? The best we can be. The best Mike, or the best, you know, put your name in there. And so, God's been speaking to me, mind my own business. I don't need to know what's going on with everybody and everything. I need to handle my own life, right? And sometimes we can, like, you know, what am I supposed to do? Well, just be at peace, you know? And so when I thought about, you know, the list that I can make, I thought about a simple thing. And this is scripture, actually. Love God, love people. Just keep it simple.
Hallelujah.
And you know, it's, you know, the commandments, love the Lord thy God with all your heart, soul, and mind, and love your neighbor as yourself. Many of you heard me mention that you know what, when trying to get a decision, I said, well, listen to God and do what God says. Now, someone asked me in more detail, they asked me to say about finances. I'll say, well, check out Tim's write-ups. But you know, someone seriously asked me, then I'll show them scripturally and what I think. But you know what? We're not called to be everybody's Holy Spirit. You know what I'm saying? I'm not called. Listen, we as a church, Dustin mentioned this a couple weeks ago. You know what? A church is not meant to be a country club, but a hospital. And in other words, and really all of us are being worked on. We're not perfected yet. We won't be perfected till we get to heaven. So what is that? Why I say that is because we're a perfect church for imperfect people. And what does that mean is, you know what? People have different issues. We might have some people don't know about. But we don't want to say, you know what? You come to these doors, you're here 3 weeks, you got to be perfected. You know what? We're going to fix you. No, God fixes. All right? And there are times we need to say something, but overall, we want God to change our lives and other people's. Is that your amen? And amen. So love God. It starts one with us being in God's presence. Last year, we did a few months on a War Room Bible study. We watched the movie. And what the main message was, you know, Matthew 6:6 is what, instead of going to people, instead of worrying, is what? To go to God, to take it to the Lord, our concerns, our people that are, are getting to us, or whatever it may be. You know, and the lady in the movie made she called her war room, but she made her closet into a prayer room.
Yes.
And so I challenged myself and all of us, beginning this year, is that we would do that. We would go to our war room, and we would go to God instead of people. But then secondly is to love people. Listen, it's not love because they love you. It's not to care for people because they care for you. No, Jesus would care, period. Amen. It's not easy. Let's be honest. That's not easy, okay? And I will say is, you know what? Start with those in your life. Start with your own family. Like for me, start with my wife. Amen. God, you know, my wife, my children, and the church family, and those. But start with our life. Now I'm saying that because it's so easy sometimes to have an outreach. You know what? And we focus love and care for people and be compassionate. But let's start with those around us that we see on a regular basis. And I have to share this. Wednesday night, I shared this after the movie, but Wednesday night, Caitlin was pretty good. I give her an A. I don't know about A+, but I'll give her an A. And you know, in the middle of the movie, she says, Daddy. I'm like, I'm watching the movie. Daddy, and I leaned over and she goes, Daddy. And it was like a part where a sad scene in the movie. She goes, you know, I just want to let you know, I'm glad you didn't die when you had cancer.
Oh.
And I was like, Then she gave me a hug. And I thought the movie was good, and it's tough with movies. There's so many opinions for reviews, and I thought, I'm glad we had that movie night just for that moment, my daughter's saying. You know what, I'm glad you didn't die. I didn't die. Anyways. But I thought about something. We forget to care for people because we get busy and people, life's easy, we didn't have to worry. But listen, heard about this story about nurses. During her second month at nursing school, the professor gave the students a quiz. The last question stumped most people in the class. It read, what is the first name of the woman who cleans the school? All the students had seen this cleaning woman several times. She was tall, dark-haired, and in her 50s. But how would any of them know her name? Before class ended, one student asked if the last question would count toward their grade. Absolutely, said the professor. In your careers, you will meet many people. All are significant. They deserve your attention and care, even if all you do is smile and say hello. And you know, I think about that when I was getting ready to have my interview at the time for my preaching license back in 1996. I was at my home church at the time. I just came back from being in El Salvador for a year. And I'm trying to think, my mom probably knows his name, but he was a preacher that was cleaning the church at the time, and in between churches, and I didn't know that, but at the time, but imagine if people, he's cleaning the, you know, there's nothing wrong with cleaning, but you know, here he is, and guess what, I interviewed with him and two other veteran pastors before I got licensed.
Hallelujah.
And so I'm just saying, we don't know who people are or what they will become, and we just need to treat everybody with respect and love and care. I know Melissa occasionally has training at work, and they'll go over that. I mentioned, you don't know what people are going through. And I remember she mentioned that her doctor, not her doctor, the doctor she worked for, I guess that patient was being very tough. I don't know what words, but the doctor said, you know, I'm not going through what they're going through, and it's okay. And so anyways, listen to a couple scriptures. If you want to turn to the passage we're going to look at, it's Isaiah 54. And if you're using a gadget, you can actually look at the Message
Amen.
Version. I don't typically use the Message version, but the Message version was, I like the wording for today. But listen to a couple scriptures as you turn there. Zephaniah 3:17. The Lord your God is with you, mighty warrior who saves.
Hallelujah.
He will take great delight in you.
Hallelujah.
Listen, mighty warriors, he saves. Galatians 5:14. For the entire law is fulfilled in keeping this one commandment. Love your neighbor as yourself. I referred to that earlier, that it refers to the Gospels. And Matthew 7:12. So in everything, do to others what you would have them do to you. In other words, treat them as you want to be treated, regardless
Amen.
Of how they treat you.
Amen.
Read one scripture, and we're going to see this video, and then we'll go into that passage of Isaiah. Well, listen, I actually talked about prophecy, and you know, sometimes I get a little airy sometimes with people. With some that I got a prophecy ministry, and some of them are legit, and then some of them you're just kind of, yeah. How many have ever met or seen some of you? But I find something amazing. Sometimes people say the way to know if a prophet is truly a prophet is if it comes true. Well, here's something amazing. What we're going to look at today is that Isaiah 54 is talking about some things that are just being fulfilled now or recently. And so some things the prophets in the Old Testament spoke of that were going to happen past their death.
Amen.
Do we realize that? It wasn't like, so how do you go, well, is he a true prophet? It's tough. Now, I agree with the statement, but the thing is, we don't know sometimes until someone passes, it can happen after they're dead. So anyways, one scripture for this is a good one to start the year. Listen, a couple months ago I did that Superman message about Jethro and Moses, and it takes a team for the kingdom of God. It takes a team as a church for us to truly be effective. And but we're going to believe for greater things and enlargement. Listen, it's Ephesians 3:20. Now to him who is able to do immeasurably more than all we ask or imagine, according to his power that is at work within us. Listen, God brings the results. We just obey him and do what he says. But listen, we got to understand God can change everything in an instant.
In a moment.
As a matter of fact, we certainly have a little less people today, but God's here. But do we realize just one of us touched, like Dwayne getting touched yesterday.
Hallelujah.
Just one of us getting that right word from God, that we can begin to see our lives and those around us changed. Listen, what happens is people are affected by the spirit they see in us and feel in us. Listen, when I walk the halls at work, many times I'll say, good morning, or give a smile, I'll say, Merry Christmas, I did last few weeks, or try it the next week, this week. Happy New Year. Happy New Year. Guess what? You'll begin to see a smile back. And you'll see 90% of the time people will smile back. Do you realize that? And now the one awkward is when you're in an elevator. You know, happy New Year. People are like, you ever notice people always go to the far corner? Like if you're in one corner and they go like this. Anyways, that's something I've noticed. Right here, Dave, go ahead and show this video. This will help us. Get ready in Isaiah 54, but watch this video first.
Impossible. How often do we hear that? You know, the written definition of the word is not capable of happening or not able to be done.
to walk around the entire earth on foot. It's impossible. You know, now that I think about it, I'm sure there have been situations where people proved impossibilities to be possible. Alexander Graham Bell, I guarantee at some point, his idea about the telephone, he heard rumors that it was not only ridiculous, but it was impossible. What about the Wright brothers? What if the Wright brothers had believed that their idea of one day flying like birds was impossible? You know what our problem may be? Maybe we rely too much on the facts of reality and statistics and theories. You know, science has answers. What if there's more to it than that? Does anyone trust in their faith when things really seem impossible? Jesus said all things are possible, everything, to him who believes. Do you believe that? Because I'll be the first one to admit, when things really get difficult in my life, I find it so tough to really trust in my faith. Jesus didn't say, if you really think about the possibilities, most things may happen. No, he said all things. You know, we sit back as a society and tell people that their dreams are impossible, when Jesus tells us that all things are possible to him who believes. I can become whatever God has destined me to become. People said a man couldn't rise from the grave. He was beaten beyond recognition, had his clothes ripped off his back, and had his hands nailed down. Nailed down to a cross and left to die a sinner's death. He was pronounced dead. Thrown into a borrowed tomb, and the world gave up on everything that he had stood for. But 3 days later, he took this world's negative, closed-minded mentality and attitude and turned it all upside down. So the next time we even think about using the words, I can't, we need to remember the Son of God stepping from death to life, overcoming the grave, and fulfilling the most impossible feat in the history of man. It really is simple. Only truly believing in the word that all things are possible is when things won't ever really seem impossible.
Amen. All things are possible. Amen. And today the title, Think Big, Stake Your Crown. And for us to understand Isaiah 54, we need to, I'm going to share just a couple of verses from 53 so we understand right before that and Isaiah's prophesying. Verse 5 and 6, but he was pierced for our transgressions. He was crushed for our iniquities. The punishment that brought us peace was on him. And by his wounds we are healed. We all, like sheep, have gone astray. There's none righteous, no, not one. Amen. Each of us has turned our own ways, and the Lord has laid on him the iniquity of us all. Recently, I was looking at Romans or the Roman Road, and you know, he even talks about, I believe it's Romans 5:8, that even before we came to him, even before we asked for forgiveness, he died for us. That's paraphrased, but he gave his life before we ever even, you know, came to him, and before we even wanted his forgiveness. And so that's the same way for us, is we should love and care people regardless of their response. And we'll be amazed at what results will happen eventually. And so as we look at Isaiah 54, understand this is prophecy, and I'm going to mention some of the prophecy is that it's to the church or God's people, to Jerusalem. And today, we're the church, God's people. And so Isaiah 54, 1 through 6. I'm going to read 1 through 6 for today. And in this subtitle on the top, it actually says, spread out, think big, in my Bible. And that's where I got the title. But listen to this. Sing, barren woman, who has never had a baby. Fill the air with song, you who have never experienced childbirth. You're ending up with far more children than all those childbearing women. God says so. If God says so, it's to be. Amen. Clear lots of ground for your tents. Make your tents large. Spread out. Think big. Use plenty of rope. drive the tent pegs deep. You're going to need lots of elbow room for your growing family. Actually, look at someone near you and say, you know what? Say this, make elbow room. Let's look at someone and say, make some elbow room. All right. And for your growing family, for our growing church family, all right? You're going to take over whole nations. You're going to resettle abandoned cities. Don't be afraid. You're not going to be embarrassed. Don't hold back. You're not going to come up short. You'll forget all the humiliations of your youth, and the indignities of being a widow will fade from memory. For your Maker is your bridegroom. His name is God of Angel Armies. Your Redeemer is the Holy of Israel, known as God of the whole earth. You were like an abandoned wife, devastated with grief, and God welcomed you back like a woman married young and then left, says your God. Your Redeemer, God says. I'll leave it there. Read the rest on your own. As I was reading that, I was thinking, Dave did a great job last week reading the Christmas story, and appreciate him doing that. I'm going to probably use him again or something like that. But I was thinking that as I was reading the scripture, and he's a solid radio communicator. Amen? Radio man. All right. And I think I had my phone one time, Dave. Radio man Dave. Like, when I had you in there. All right. But listen, as we, I'm going on here some of the notes. This is about the restoration of Israel. The wife of the Lord, the Babylonian exile and captivity meant more than oppression for Israel. It meant shame, disgrace, and humiliation. I was certainly encouraged to study deeper. Basically, he's prophesying to God's people, Jerusalem. They've been in exile in Babylon, but they're about to be set free. And so we're going to look at this in a practical sense for ourselves. And so first of all, as we look at this passage, specifically the first six verses, and I'm also connecting this in a way from the Superman message, because certainly we can build a team, but with a team without a vision for greater things, you're not going to go anywhere. You can have a well-built team, but it's amazing if you have the right coach, if you have the right vision of what a team can do. And by the way, pray for my Dolphins. They're playing the Patriots today. All right, so I'm just sleeping. All right. First of all, sing and shout. When we woke up this morning, guess who was shouting? No, it wasn't the ladies in the house. It was Caleb. He was shouting and making noises. He was ready to get up. But listen, Isaiah 54:1. It says, sing, barren woman, you who never bore a child, burst into song, shout for joy. I believe God is speaking to us to begin to what? Sing and shout. I'll do some shouting. I'll let my wife do the singing. Philippians 4:4, rejoice in the Lord always. I will say it again, rejoice. Listen, the word is telling us what to celebrate on credit. He's prophesying, speaking here in this chapter, and he's saying, listen, you've been barren, you've been without, but you know what? Get ready, get ready, get ready. And listen, what? God sees a heart that's excited before you see everything come to fruition. He gets excited when he sees people that are singing and shouting and praising when it had all come to be, when the days aren't all perfect. When you wake up on Monday for work, you know, some may be off tomorrow, but the Monday for work, begin to wake up. Man, let's begin to scare the devil. Let's get up and get excited. Instead of being, oh me, oh my, say yes, another day. Well, that would be a good habit to start in the new year. All right, tomorrow, wake up. I'm awake. Even before you get your coffee, all right? Even before you get your shower. And let's do an example. Listen, many athletes celebrate after a win and a good play. Listen, Clemson will get excited they beat Alabama. All right? But have you ever seen a few players? Now, many think they're kind of prideful, but they get confident. There's some confident teams and players that shout out before the game. How many of you see that? Listen, I know the end of the book. I know the end of the story. And we can begin to sing and shout before we see the results, because we know the results. We can cheat and look at the end of the book and we win. We are winners, we are champions. Matter of fact, look at someone there and say, I'm a champion, I'm a winner, all right? Amen. Begin to declare it, sing it, and shout it. Secondly, stop dwelling on past, the past. Listen, I think we'd all raise our hands and say we have a past. There are some things and some decisions, even the last month, year, whatever, some point in our life, that if we put it on the screen, we'd be ashamed of. Now, if not, praise God, but listen, God doesn't want us to dwell on the past. We learn from the past, but we move on. Do not be afraid, verse 4, you will not be put to shame. Do not fear disgrace, you will not be humiliated. You will forget the shame of your youth, to remember no more the reproach of your widowhood. You know what I've heard? If you think about it, even if you look at the disciples and many that God used in the Bible, many churches probably wouldn't even use. Think about Paul that was killing Christians within a week or a short period. He's preaching and leading the church. And if you think about David, his sins of murder and sins of adultery, but what? Next thing you know, most of the Psalms is written after that happened. Now, certainly, it doesn't bring endorsement for doing wrong. Hopefully, we learn from others. But however, God can use and turn a life around. Philippians 3:13, brothers and sisters, I do not consider myself yet to have taken hold of it. I'll have to say amen to that. I'm growing, I'm learning. But one thing I do, forgetting what is behind and straining toward what is ahead. Now, I have actually used this to remember, like the Jethro and Moses. The one thing I do, meaning that each one of us should do what God calls us to do, we're able to do, gifted to do. But if you look at the verse, really, Paul in that Philippians 3 is saying, I don't dwell on the past. I move forward. I learn from the past. Thirdly, spread out. Think big. Spread out. Think big. Isaiah 54, verse 2. You have never experienced childbirth. You're ending up with far more children than all those childbearing women. God says so. If God says so, it's to be. Clear lots of ground for your tents. Make your tents large.
Hallelujah.
Spread out. Think big. Listen, in our lives and as a church, let's spread out. Let's think big.
Yes, Jesus.
Let's don't look at what we had or what's happened in the past. Don't look at it. Yes, we should make a plan, but however, God's plans are bigger than our plans.
Yes.
He doesn't always show us all the details. Now, I will give you a little bit of understanding with this passage. They're talking about tents. Is that in this day and with many of the people, they lived nomad ways. Basically, they would travel and they would set up tents, okay, and without getting into more details. And you say, you know what, make an extra room and stretch out. And when it said spread out, maybe some of this Tim may know, they would stretch the fabric further and they'd have to stake it down harder. And I've done some tent camping, but it's been a while. But they'd stretch out, they'd make another room, and it would take a little more work. But you built the tents according to what you think you would have, family-wise or community-wise. But God is saying to build the tent bigger, to spread it out and enlarge it.
Thank you, Father.
And He's saying that for our lives, but also as a church.
Yes, thank you, Father.
Amen?
Amen.
Stake your ground is number 4. Listen to this. Use plenty of rope. Drive the tent pegs deep. You're going to need lots of elbow room. All right, there was that elbow room. You know, I've heard people ask, you know, we obviously took out, when we first got this building, there was pews, 3 or 4 up here. It was all like 2 more rows. There was a row in the back. I guess in the day, you had like maybe piano and other instruments. But we made a little more elbow room. But also, they say we could fit like 100 people. But that's like if you're sitting like next to people. They've proven that people don't like to be sitting so close to people. Is that true? Mm-hmm. Are you all would agree with that? And so, really, they say whatever your max is in seating, you can hold really 80% of that before people are getting a little, You know, I care for everybody, but I don't really know this person. I don't want to sit that close. And they want some elbow room, man. And so listen, we're believing in our lives, but as a church, we're going to be needing more elbow room. That means we're going to be expanding. We're going to be expanding and appreciate Joan working with our children. I was impressed. She taught the day I did about Zechariah and that story. She taught the children, and I quizzed Caitlin, and she knew the answers from Joan teacher that day. Kids have absorbed. But you know what? We've been praying. Caitlin's been praying for 20 children. And you know what? For 20 children, we'll need more people that love children and are gifted with children.
Yes.
You know, as we grow, we... with musicians, it's great to see Dwayne and Dwayne up here, you know, but we're going to wait for where we have even backup. Now, backup doesn't mean that they're not used, but we're going to believe. But you know what? Whatever we have each week, we're going to be blessed. God's presence, most of all, in the Word. And amen, is that true? Yeah. And appreciate Dave. Dave's here on Sundays now. All right, he's done his job. Praise God. He said, I'm here. I go to church. It's on my schedule. He's taking an example of Crystal. He put it on his schedule to see bosses. I'm like, all right, it's on my phone. And so stay your ground. Listen to this. Here's what a stake is. A strong wooden or metal post with a plank at one end, driven into the ground to support a tree, form part of a fence. Catch this one. Act as a boundary mark. Mark an area with stakes so as to claim, catch this part, to claim ownership of it. The boundary between the two ranches with property staked out. Listen right here, Luke 4:19. This is God's year to act, to announce. This is God's year to act. 2017 is our year, my year, our year, individually as a church. We're claiming it, and not only are we claiming it, we are staking it. We are going to declare it, and you know what? We're going to believe. Now, when we're staking it, yes, maybe we need a stake in our property or whatever, but we're saying, you know what, devil, you don't have ownership of my life. Devil, you don't have ownership of my family. You don't have ownership of my finances. You don't have ownership of my church. But no, I'm putting a stake into it. And the stake says, think big, and it has the passage on it to remind us. And so if you need to carry this or put this in your car, and this, I believe, would be similar type stakes they would have used back in Old Testament. Now, I don't know if they're right wood, I'm not sure, but I think they would have used wooden stakes. Maybe Tim will do a background on that and do a write-up. But here you go, Joan. And you know what? Begin to say, as you use this, and maybe you can have this handy the next 3 weeks as we seek the Lord in prayer and fasting, we're going to believe that we're going to put a stake in ownership, that it's God, our lives are God's, all right, in the name of Jesus. As you begin to hear God speak to you, and as God begins to prophesy through you or in your life, Dwayne and I can give you more words in the name of Jesus. Listen, I believe that... About a week, I'm in the car. She goes, Dad, do you know that you don't own the church? I was like, yeah, I know that. She says, God is the authority. I was like, she's getting like theologically. I don't know if Joan taught her that. Maybe Joan. And I said, well, that's true, but the pastor draws, God speaks to the pastor, but God can speak to all of us at times, the team. All right, amen. We agree on that. But I'm believing, as you go to your war room prayer in the next few weeks at UNS Church, here you go, Dave, let me see and catch. All right, Dave caught it, good job. Mom, catch. No, I'm just kidding. And she got nervous there. And here you go, Pop's dead, Grandpa, or as Kevin says, Papa, Papa, Papa. And here's what I'm going to do. We're going to pray.
Hallelujah.
And I'm going to pray. But listen. You know what? The devil has had ownership over some of us. We've allowed him to speak about our past. We've allowed him to say things aren't going to change. But you know, we're declaring God's word.
Amen.
That you know what? No longer. We are moving forward. This is our year. Listen, we got closed ears. Listen to us in our lives. When people begin to, people like to yip-yap and be busybodies. Do we realize that? People at work, I already call it water cooler talk, is what I heard at work, is what they call it. But you know what? We need to have closed ears. closed ears to that talk, that stuff. We need open ears to God and God talk. And when people begin to talk about people in our lives, at church, at work, you know, I say, no, you know what? I'm praying for that person. Let's just pray for that person. And now some people will say, I got a prayer request and a little gossip. We don't need that, no. No, closed ears.
Amen.
You know what? I'm thinking big. And Melissa was talking about that at work. What was it? I forget what you call it, about minding your own business. You turned this on now. But she's talking to a coworker. You know what? They were talking to each other. You know what? No, we're just going to mind. And that's what we're going to do. We're going to think big for our own lives, but also we're going to think big for other people.
Amen.
People can change by God. And you know what? It's a miracle. I bet you there's testimonies here in this room of God transforming. I know Tim shared a couple times where he had left the church and you know what? God touched his heart and now he's leading worship.
Hallelujah.
And he'll give more testimonies on this. He has given time. But you know what? We're thinking big. So I'm going to pray and then let's come up front and we'll pray together.
Amen.
And you know what? It's going to be God that's going to do it. God's doing it.
Hallelujah.
God changes. Yes, we should plan. We should make plans in our lives. We should make a schedule in a church reasonably. But we want to be a church of miracles. We want to be people that God moves through. And it's unexplainable. That's not explainable. Amen?
Amen.
Lord God, I just pray right now, we are claiming, hey, think big. We're claiming in the name of Jesus that we're staking ground spiritually and in different ways, but we're going to nail the stakes deep in the name of Jesus. We're not going to be swayed by circumstances, swayed by situations, swayed by what people think or the critics. We're going to be swayed by your word. We're going to be deep in your word. We're going to be deep in what you want, how you want, and when you want it, in the name of Jesus.
Yes, Lord. Yes.
We know, Lord God, that you are not short on finances. You're not short on resources. You're not short on healing. You're not short on anything, but you come through, Lord God. And Lord, we thank you. We thank you. And Lord, we're praying and declaring for those here, those that are part of this church, those that are in our families, and those that would see this message, that in the name of Jesus, that 2017, this year is our year. We're believing this will be a year of jubilee. And we thank you.
Hallelujah.
In Jesus' name.
Thank you, Jesus.
In Jesus' name, amen. 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 Let's come to the front. Let's pray together.